So today what I want to talk about is the classification of matter. That's one of the concepts in chapter 1. And matter is anything that takes up space. And I just need to start the pen here. Matter, anything that takes up space. The clothes you wear, the food you eat, the air you breathe, the water you drink, all of those things are matter. They take up space. They have a mass. Remember, mass is the inherent amount of matter in an object, and that's different than weight. Weight is the gravitational force acting on the matter, or the mass. So, in science, we generally talk about items or substances in terms of mass, and we'll be using grams to represent that mass. We do not use weight that much in chemistry because, again, weight fluctuates depending on the gravitational force. What is not matter? Energy is not matter. Heat, light, electricity, those are all forms of energy, and we do not consider those matter. So when we're thinking about a substance that takes up space, matter, the first decision we have to make is the matter pure or is it a mixture? If it's pure, that means it's only one substance or one component. One component. There's only two pure substances in the universe, and those are elements and compounds. Elements are a group of atoms that have the same number of protons in the nucleus, and we'll define nucleus and protons later. But an atom is the building block of substances that have specific chemical properties, and they are a group of atoms that have the same number of protons that define a particular element, such as hydrogen. All hydrogen in the universe has one proton. Elements cannot be broken down any further and retain their chemical properties. So an element is the simplest substance in the universe that has chemical properties. Compounds. Compounds are two or more elements bonded together two or more different elements. It's got to be different elements. Different elements bonded together in a fixed whole number ratio. Now, what that means is that, okay, we have two elements, at least two different elements, hydrogen and oxygen. When those bond together, if we call it water, it is two hydrogen atoms bonded to an oxygen atom, or hydrogen element and oxygen element. Anywhere in the universe, if we call it water, it's always H2O. And the two, as a subscript here, says that two hydrogens are, illustrates that two hydrogens are bonded to an oxygen. If we change it and make it H2O2, yes, that's a compound, but that's no longer called water. It's called hydrogen peroxide. So, compounds, elements, one or the other, a pure substance, one component, that's all there is. If you start mixing compounds or you start mixing elements, you have a mixture. A mixture is two or more components. In a variable composition. The variable composition is what really distinguishes it between compounds. Compounds have a fixed composition. Mixtures can have a variable composition. Mixtures are things like salt and water. If you have a cup of water, you could add 1 teaspoon of salt. You could add 2 teaspoons of salt. You could add 5 teaspoons of salt. As we add more salt to that 1 cup of water, it becomes more concentrated in the salt. So that's variable composition. Mixtures come in two types, homogeneous and heterogeneous. Homogeneous means one phase. Heterogeneous means more than one phase. So homogeneous mixtures, again, two or more components. Let's take air, for instance. The air that you're breathing consists of the elements oxygen, written as O2, nitrogen, and other gases. So it has oxygen, nitrogen, and other gases. It's a mixture. It has two or more components. But when you look at the air between your eyes and the computer screen, you see only one phase. It's all clear. It's transparent. It's not cloudy. And so that is the air that you breathe is a homogeneous mixture. On the other hand, if you look at muddy water or concrete or soda pop where the cap is off and you can see the bubbles in the liquid, that is two or more components and you see more than one phase. With the soda pop, you see the air bubbles that contain, or the carbon dioxide bubbles, and then you see the liquid. And so those are two different phases. Concrete, you can distinguish the cement from the sand, from the rock. Again, heterogeneous mixture. Homogeneous is like you put a teaspoon of salt in water and you stir it up until all the salt dissolves. Again, all one phase. And it is uniform in the distribution of the salt throughout the water. Here's a classic example between homogeneous and heterogeneous. The air that you're breathing contains water. That's what we call humidity. So when you drive at night and you turn your car lights on a low humidity night, the light leaves the car and it strikes a tree out in front and it illuminates the tree. On a foggy night, you see the light beam leaving the car all the way to the tree. You can actually see the beam of light. Now what's happening here is the water droplets in the air are so large that they begin scattering light. And that's why you can see the car beam from your car all the way to the tree. That's also why you're not supposed to turn your high beams on when it's foggy, because it's going to cause more light scattering and it may blind objects in front of you. So when water droplets in fog get large enough to scatter light, we say that's a heterogeneous mixture. And that's the number one indicator of a heterogeneous mixture. If you shine a light through the substance and you can see the beam going through the substance, traversing the substance, then you have a heterogeneous mixture. The particles suspended in the mixture are large enough to scatter light. Another example would be milk. Milk is a heterogeneous mixture. There are particles suspended in the liquid, whey or water, whichever way you want to think of it, that scatter light. And in whole milk, you can see that the milk is really white because the particles are fairly large. In skim milk, you've taken out the fat, the particles are smaller, and so the scattering is a little blue shift. That's why skim milk looks kind of grayish, green, or blue looking, because the particles are smaller. You say, well, but I can't see the beam going through it. Well, if you had a strong enough light, yes, you would see the beam traversing through the milk.